mucho inglés, right?
Well, I'm going to speak in English. And here's what we're going to do. We're going to play a game. Then we're going to take a break. Then I'm going to give a lecture. Then we're going to have questions. And the questions will include the question, why the hell did we play the game? Okay? So I'm not going to tell you why we're going to play the game. We're just going to play the game. And I thought, what would be a game that would be instructive and interesting and relevant to the topic of education? So I decided, well, I'm from the United States and you're from Colombia. Both of us love guns, right? Americans love guns. We love shooting guns, as you've seen, tragically, in our country. But since Colombia has embarked on an era of paz, equidad, y educación, right? You all understand your government is about paz, equidad, y educación. We're going to play with toy guns. Okay? And here's the game we're going to play. You see these six objects. We're going to draw a circle on the ground outside. Okay? And this has already been done, but we're just going to take a circle. We're going to take a piece of chalk like this. And we're going to draw a circle on the ground sort of like this. Okay? Is this what you expected so far? Then we're going to label this circle like a clock. So here's 12, here's 1, 2, 3, etc., 6, 9. So outside there's going to be six different circles. And into the middle of that circle, we're going to put one of these six objects randomly. And you guys aren't going to know which of the objects is in your circle. Okay? So, we may randomly choose the boot. And we're going to put it in the middle of the circle, and it's going to be oriented in that way. And this picture is showing you the orientation of the objects oriented to six. You see what I'm saying? So this picture is taken from six looking to 12. Okay? Then, where's my cards? I've got six different people who are the shooters. And they're going to bring you a card. And the way you're going to guess what object is in your circle is you're going to take shots with a gun. And what you can say about what the shot is from what point on the clock to what point on the clock, at what height, and then your card you're going to give it, there's going to be runners, when you've got a guess for your group, and you're working in groups of six to decide how to take guesses, right? You hold your card up, somebody takes the card, they go out, one of the six shooters, raise your hands, shooters, one of the six shooters takes the shot and holds them to. That is it. Hacia, altura, and then they write down what happened. And then you think, oh. And then you make memories. And the object is to guess what's in the middle of your circle of these six objects. Okay? Everybody got it? So, if your first guess, what? Okay, this is it. Let me demonstrate. So if this group said, we want to shoot desde 6 hacia 12 a los 3 centímetros de altura, ellos hacen eso, bingo, y salió the circle a las 6. Ellos escriben 6 y le devuelven el paquete. ¿Más bien? Okay.
object, your only, again, I think you're right, your only tool for discovering the object is this gun, and the only piece of information is where the dart left the circle, or perhaps that it didn't leave the circle. You can imagine a shot in which it entangles in some way with one of these objects and doesn't leave the circle. Okay? That's the only information that's written down. El resultado es the punta del reloj donde salió después de los shots, right? Now, obviamente si, and I'm not going to say anything about it. Okay, great. So, the objects, put the picture back up. The objects are oriented with respect to the number 6 exactly in this picture. So, si fue el libro está así. See what I'm saying? So, we're going to leave this picture up on the screen so you can say, okay, that is how they're looking relative to 6. Because some of these objects, as you notice, are not symmetric. They're not rotationally symmetric. Where was the physicist? He probably was talking about rotationally symmetric, right? So it matters what their orientation is, but they're oriented. This picture is taken from 6.
All right.
Okay? Okay, now, the runners, the gun, the shooters are going to bring you a card like this. Then just discuss among your group, how are you going to decide what shots to take? Right? When you're ready to take shots, you can take 3 shots at once, you can take 1 at a time, you can take 5 at a time. When you've written down the exact hacia, donde, no, desde, hacia, altura, you raise it up and we'll have some runners take it outside, and then they'll come back with information. Vamos? Vamos, chico? Great, okay.
Escribirlo, because I've found if you don't write it down, once you find out the truth, then there's a temptation to, oh yeah, that's what we thought. Okay, so everybody's got their guess written down on their card, right? Okay. So let's start with group three. Does everybody know their number? Like, you notice their cards are numbered in a different way. But group LK, who's group LK? You guys remember? What? You should be in group three. LK, are you LK? You guys are LK. So group three, oh shoot, I've written this down wrong. There's something, this list and that list are not the same. I use this list.
It's the same.
But group one, it says group three. It looks like there's an LK. Is that CK?
Excuse me.
Okay. Sorry.
Yeah. Say CK.
Let's put the names of the people.
So yeah, put
that
the.
One is my.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah, put the names of the people.
Okay.
No. Okay, we're putting the names of the people that the card was going out to. Okay, so group CK. Who's group CK? Will the real group CK please stand up? Okay. You should have been sending your card out to Carlos. You were in group three, group CK. Okay, you're CK. What was your guess? What?
The basket,
okay. We can do this in Spanish, I guess, as long as we all agree. Canasta? We'll call it la canasta? Okay, now, anybody else in group three? So who was in group three? You were sending your cards out to Carlos. Guessed anything else? What did you get? What?
The pillow.
Should we call it the pillow?
Almohada.
Almohada. And what group are you?
Group number, but
the letter name.
CK.
There can't be two CKs.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, can there be? Okay. Great, okay. Okay, let's go to group six. Group JF of group six. Group six is back here. Who's group JF? Okay, what was your guess? The boot. The book. El libro. Okay. Anybody else in group six guess something that wasn't the libro?
Botella.
Okay. What group are you?
The same. Could be the same. It's the same.
It's the same?
Yeah.
This is confusing as hell.
It's like eight of these letters could be.
Okay. Group one. Group one. You guessed botella. Okay, you're all realizing that you're all wrong, right? Because it can't be the case that you're both right and they're right. Because you know they were shooting at different objects. Anybody in group one guess something besides the botella? The almohada. This could not work better, could it? Almohada. Group two. Where's group two? You, the guy with the beard and the barbudo in the back. In the back. Yeah. Well, how do we call it? Bota. Almohada. Oh man, we messed with these people's heads, didn't we? Okay, group four. Where's group four? The botella? Okay. Okay, other for what? The bota? No, but different. Sorry. El libro. Almohada, okay. Okay, now, get the shooters. The shooters now come in with the objects in their hands, okay? So, I'm a development economist. Since there was a field called development as a specific area of endeavor, starting in about the 1950s, everybody has known education was crucial to development. The idea that development discovered human capital or human development in the 80s or 90s is complete crap. Everybody who wrote about development in the 1950s stressed that education was going to be key to development. Your grandparents knew education was key to development, right? But if that was so, if everybody knew education was crucial to development, how is it that the education systems around the world are so spectacularly awful? How have we not made more progress in the world? Well, 70 years after education is declared a human right, the levels of learning that children have from attending school are just around the world are just unbelievably spectacularly low. So let me show you two pieces of data. And again, these are just illustrative. For every slide that I show you today, I could show you 10 slides that make the same point. So I'm just showing you illustrations. But these are new illustrations that you've never seen because these are papers that I'm working on that aren't in the public domain. So since you came to hear me in person, you get to hear something new. So the first is, there's a large-scale data set called the Demographic and Health Survey that goes around the world and interviews nationally representative samples of women aged 15 to 44. And what they've added to these surveys is on a card written in the native language or in a whole variety of languages so the woman can choose the language, is a simple sentence like, farming is hard work. And they show that to the woman and ask if she can read it. Okay, so this is not like sophisticated test of literacy. This is just, can you read a single simple sentence? Okay? So, and by the way, you know, it's parents must care for their children, farming is her work. This is what grade 6 is expected in the state that I live in. This is a typical sentence to assess grade 6 reading in my state of Massachusetts. So just for comparison, we're not assessing anything sophisticated. Okay? Now, what percent of women who, having completed grade 6, can read a single sentence? I want you to write it down. And I know pen and paper is like obsolete, but I also know you all got a gift of a little notebook. Because again, I just want you to write it down. Think about it. What percent in the world do you think? What, you know, there's 50 countries in my sample. Kind of what's the typical percent of women who, as adults, and this is only adult women, we only are looking at adult women in their 20s to 30s, so young adult women who, having persisted through elementary education, can read a single sentence. Okay, in America, we play this music. Da, 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 da. I'm waiting for you to write something down. Like I can see you, you know. The lights aren't down in the auditorium. We ready?
Yes.
Okay, she's holding up her answer. What's your guess?
Eight.
Eight? Wow, you are a pessimist. Eight or 80?
Eight.
Eight. Other guesses? What? 30%. Did you guys go to elementary school? Couldn't you read a grade six? What?
60.
Other guesses?
19.
Okay. So, and this is a little tricky. So the answer is, it goes from 0 to 100. So some countries in the world, like Sierra Leone and Ghana, less than 10%. In Nigeria, these are acronyms that I use all the time. In Nigeria, 12% of women who have completed grade six can read a single sentence. How can it be that awful? I mean, think of this poor person. They got up every morning and they got dressed and went to school. 200 days a year for 6 years of their life. And what did they get from it? They can't read as an adult a single sentence. That's 88% of them. Now, it varies a lot. It varies basically from 0 to 1. Surprisingly to me, at least, given that I have negative attitudes about Bolivia. I share those with some people in the audience, I see. Bolivia, it's 100%. Basically, everyone who completed grade 6 in Bolivia can read. And again, that shouldn't be surprising, right? Like 6 years of school, you should be able to read a single simple sentence. And one of these countries with near 100% is Rwanda. So a super poor country, not that long out of a super terrible conflict, roughly 100% of the kids that can. Now, how does this happen? Well, we actually can compute the trajectory. And this is a very, very busy graph, but it's we can compute for each country the trajectory. So this is the fraction that can read a single sentence at the highest grade attained. So the number I just showed you was this slice on the data, right? But the question is, how can it be though? That is an approximate answer. The answer is there's a whole bunch of countries where basically nobody's learning anything in the first three grades. So I'm going to stand on these chairs. That's what I'll do. I was going to move them. Now you'll remember three things about the lecture. So there's a whole bunch of countries in which in grade 3 or 4 you still have less than 1 in 5 kids in the classroom who can read a sentence. Now, I think there's some real teachers in the room, right? Okay. Imagine trying to teach the fourth grade curriculum when 4 out of 5 kids can't read a sentence. Right? It's just impossible, because by grade 4, most knowledge has, you know, you're adopting text-based modes of teaching, right? So basically, if you don't get literacy early in substantial enough, it just, you basically, large people, A, start to drop out, and B, just never get it. Because you just get left behind. Right? Imagine you're in a fifth grade classroom and you can't read. Like, what do you do? Right? You just twiddle your thumbs, because it's like, you can have no way of participating in what's going on. So, unbelievably awful, right? It's unbelievably awful that people, and by the way, I'm just showing these results for women. I suspect the scores for men would be roughly almost as awful. You know, India, only 1 in 3 women who persisted through grade 6 can read a sentence. That's 1 billion people, a country with 1 billion people. Anyway, okay, so I'm just showing you that it is awful, and it's like India has been an independent country since 1948. India has had the rhetoric that education is key to their development prospects since 1948. Nobody's been ignoring education. Kids have, in fact, been going to school in greater and greater and greater numbers. The problem is, how can it be this awful? How can it be that we've got kids persisting through school, basically not learning anything, right? And for all of you who've been searching for Colombian here, it's not there. Because if Colombia were there, then we'd have a bunch of fights about whether or not the number was accurate for Colombia. Okay, let me just show 1 second example of how awful it is. Which is, the OECD carried out a very sophisticated, and by the way, Indonesia had 75%. So of countries in the world, Indonesia is actually one of the better countries of this assessment of literacy, right? Now we're going to see some data about Indonesia. The OECD has carried out a very psychometrically sophisticated assessment of learning proficiency that actually kind of tests literacy in the way that psychometrically sophisticated people would test literacy. And they test mostly OECD countries, but in the second round, they tested just Jakarta, Indonesia. So just the capital city of Indonesia, which then one would suspect is quite a high performer relative to the rest of the country. You would suspect the capital city would have the best and brightest. You're all nodding because here you are in the capital city, right? Okay. Here is a comparison of Indonesia's results with Denmark's results. And it turns out that people in Indonesia who have a tertiary education, have been to higher education beyond upper secondary of an academic type, this doesn't include technical training, score exactly the same on literacy as people in Denmark who haven't completed high school. That's amazing, right? Stop and think of that. So, you go to Indonesia, you hire somebody with a college degree, and they're on average, in the capital city, they're on average going to have not anything like what someone in Denmark with a tertiary degree has. They're going to be way behind somebody from Denmark with a high school degree. They're going to have the same literacy proficiency, the ability to read texts and decode them and elicit information and reason with texts that someone who dropped out of high school in Denmark has. What's my question? How can it be this bad? And by the way, Indonesian, we just saw, is a high performer. Like, has twice the literacy of India, twice the literacy of Bangladesh, 7 times the simple assessed literacy of Nigeria. Okay? So, how can it be this bad? How can 70 years into human education being a human right, 60 years into countries being independent sovereign countries, who all of whom have always emphasized education as an important part of their development policy, still be in the position where the poorly performing countries' kids are learning next to nothing, and in the well-performing countries, they're getting this relative to the OECD? When countries like Vietnam score, which are resource poor as any country, much significantly poorer than Indonesia, is actually scoring at OECD levels. So, and by the way, the gap is getting worse over time. So if we compare the gap by cohort, since you're interviewing adults, this is an adult assessment, not a student assessment, the gap between the OECD and Jakarta is actually larger now than it was for people who went to school 30 years ago. In spite of the fact that the proportion of Indonesians who go to school in this cohort is enormously larger. Right? It's about twice as high. So about 30% of people completed upper secondary in this cohort, and about, 30 percentage points more people in this cohort completed upper secondary than in this cohort, and yet that's the total progress in the adult skill set. Okay? That's, I think, a hard, interesting question. Okay. So now I want to just make one point in the remaining 10 minutes that I'm going to lecture. And that is that it's very easy in discussions of the economics of education and the discussion of education more generally to confuse the normative with the positive. The normative is what an agent, and an agent can be an organization, can be a government, can be a firm, can be an NGO. The normative is, I have a model about what you should do in order to achieve your objectives. If you were attempting to achieve your objectives successfully, this is a description of what you would be doing. That's a normative model. So we as economists, if we think about firms and we say you're a firm and you're trying to maximize profits, here's a normative theory of what firms should do in order to maximize profits. Right? That's a normative theory. A second is a positive theory. And that's a theory about what agents actually do, right? It's a theory of what actually happens, what firms are actually doing, what governments are actually doing. And the difficulty is, since our, economists, we have a very powerful normative theoretical apparatus, right? We're very good at saying, suppose we had an agent who was attempting to maximize the well-being of everybody in society, weighted in some way, right? We'll take some individual indicator of well-being and we'll aggregate it across people, and we have a sort of agent who's attempting to make that as good as possible. Our normative theory says exactly what that person should do. If they were attempting to maximize, here's what they should do, right? And in particular, it says if there was a market failure or if there are inequalities, then there's an intervention in the existing outcome that this agent could take. It could be a regulation, it could be a policy, a program. This benevolent agent could undertake actions that would improve on the market outcome, right? And this is basic economics 101. If you've had any economics, you should have learned that there's a market outcome, and then there's a market failure, and if there's a market failure, there's an ability to intervene to achieve better outcomes than the market achieves. Right? And we're probably... the problem is that you can easily get into this following mythological mindset, which is our normative theory says there's lots of reasons why governments should be involved in education. Fact is, we observe governments involved in education, right? Here is the extraordinarily stupid and yet widely accepted and very pernicious conclusion, which is, since there are reasons a benevolent welfare maximizers would be intervening, and since the actual government is intervening, the government is intervening because it's acting like a benevolent welfare maximizer, and hence is acting as a positive description of their action in a way to make things better off. We assume that the positive description corresponds to the normative description. Right? Why is this pernicious? This is pernicious because if you believe this, then kind of getting more resources into the hand of the government is all you need to do. Right? If the government is in fact doing the normatively correct thing, there's not like a ton to worry about. Right? And hence, your advocacy for education is kind of A, advocacy to just do more, and B, is advocacy on the premise that the people who are the objects of your advocacy, the mythical policymaker, roughly have the objectives of making things better. They're behaving in a roughly normatively attractive way that would, in fact, if they were able to do it and implement it and had all the right information, lead to the right outcome. Okay? So, this is what I call NAP, normative is positive, right? But kind of, and I have a whole bunch, I have a whole bunch of slides that I'm not going to show you, but I'll leave with the organizers, and they're kind of in the papers because I want to stop and do something else. This model's just as wrong as it can possibly be, right? And the first way it's wrong is just think back. If, in fact, governments around the world were doing what they were doing in education in the normatively desirable way, could we really be seeing the awful results we're seeing? Right? So we see Nigeria spending money on schools. And we always say, oh, geez, look, Nigeria is acting like a benevolent welfare maximizer. They're optimizing the allocation of public resources to increase human capital. What we need to do is get them more budget. But then you have to stop and ask yourself, if Nigeria were really acting in the normatively desirable way, could it really be that only 12% of women could read after attending sixth grade of school? Okay? Now, it's just now, and I have, and this irritates some people, pleases others, I have six different sort of empirical ways in which, come back to the analogy of the game, when you went to think about how to take a shot, how did you decide? You said, well, it could either be the boot or it's the bottle. And if we take the shot and it's the boot, the dart should behave like this. If it's the bottle, the dart should behave in another way. Okay? So you had a So believe it or not, you all had a theory, right? You had a theory about the world. Because if you don't have a theory, data can't help you. There's a myth out there in the world that evidence is what matters. Complete, total nonsense. Theory is what matters. Because if you don't have a theory, you can't have evidence. And you can't read evidence, you can't understand evidence, and you can't create evidence, okay? So, the point is, if we take the normative model, and we say, if the normative model would be true, what should be true about what we observe in the world? And then the rest of this presentation, I list six things that should be true in the world. None of the six are true. None of the six are anywhere close to true. Some of the six are as far from true as could possibly be. So, and these are the six. So this is saying, if normative were in the middle of the circle and data were being shot at it, right? I was trying to assess whether or not truly in the middle of the circle was a normatively optimizing actor that was controlling school in an efficient way. What should be true about the world? And these things are puzzles because they don't correspond to what should happen if that were true. Right? And there's six of them. And I'm not even going to list them because all of you have read papers. Okay. So, now I'm going to say two things about the game we played. The game we played was designing a research project. Right? If any of you ever have to design a research project of any kind, from the simplest to the most complex, This was a research project. We have various hypotheses about what might be in the middle of the circle. We form a model to say, if this were in the middle of the circle, and we undertook this following measurement of what happens in response to pinging against the world in various ways, we have different theories about what would happen in response to different hypotheses, and we elicit information, right? And the essence of research is taking the right shot, right? Again, there's a lot of enthusiasm for big data, right? Suppose you took 1,000 shots at this height in every direction. How would that have helped you? Bupkis. That's an English word. Zero. Because you would have had lots of data that didn't have any differentiating power relative to your hypothesis. Under all of the possibilities, all of those darts go through at this height. Right? So the essence of evidence is taking the right shot relative to well-articulated hypotheses about what the world really looks like. Okay? So now here's what I want to do. And again, I know that you'd rather ask me questions than have me lecture to you, so I've now stopped my lecture at 27 minutes and 13 seconds, so not quite 25 minutes, like I said. And here's what I want you to do. Each of you should have read a paper, right? And you should be in groups where other people in your group have read a different paper. Is that true? It will very quickly be revealed if you didn't read the paper, because we're going to do something here. Okay. What I want you to do is form into your groups, and you should be in groups of six so that you've read different papers. And I want to give you 5 minutes, and maybe we'll take 10, depending on whether it's productive. Discuss amongst your group what question you should ask me. Right? Because here I am live. I could talk about lots of different things, but I want you guys to say, what would you like me to answer given what you've read? So what I'd like you to do, and this is going to actually, I'm changing my mind, we're going to take 10 minutes, that's still going to give us 20 minutes for questions. I want each of you to go around the circle, and I read this paper, and here's basically what it said, summarize your paper in 1 minute, right? And every one of my papers is really boneheadedly simple. That's my specialty, is boneheadedness. I write really simple papers. So you should be able to summarize them in 1 minute. Then discuss among the group what's the one question you as a group would like to ask me that would most help you with your thinking about education. Okay? Go. 5 minutes? Or 10 minutes? We're going to take 10 minutes. So discuss amongst yourself for 5 minutes. Then for 5 minutes, discuss what the question is. I want to take 3 questions. So your groups have been discussing what's a good question. So I want the people with the 3 best questions to raise their hands. Oh, your hand was up before I even said that. So you've got a really great question, you've got a really great question, and you've got a really great question, right? So let's, and then we'll take those 3, and then we'll take 3 more. Did you have a great question? Okay. Was there one? Which one? The woman in the turquoise.
Okay.
And then the guy standing back there, and then this
guy. Yeah, but he doesn't make.
Well, Professor, firstly, thank you for being here and teaching us so much. The question that we have here, according to the article that we read, thinking about education in India, we were comparing things and elements, and we found many similarities in India and here, and in other parts of Latin America, of course. So one of the questions that we have is what do we need, or what elements do we need to join coverage and quality in public education? Because when we think about different models, we know that in other parts of the world, the inversion for education is higher. So we are trying to do that here, and we are just worried about that. How can we start with some elements that allow teachers to achieve quality when we have so many children in classrooms? So we are thinking about 40 children, one teacher. So how can we start without being utopic? How can we start? Okay, so that is the question.
What's the second one?
Well, Professor, in first place, saying thank you for being here. Well, we are, with this discussion, we are starting from the point that our systems of education, we are thinking them, building them, based on economic models, and that's not bad. The problem is that we are, well, the education systems have been fought for, and are being copied across different countries, and those cognitive skills you talk in your paper, those competences, we are trying to standardize it up across all the world, so maybe something that may function in some countries may not function in others. So we are basically, the education process basically is just like going into a factory, students came with some skills, maybe natural skills, and they are passing through a process of 10 to 12 years, and in the end, they are just like a product. There's a hierarchy of some areas, mathematics, reading, those things. But what about creativity? What about some other cognitive and social skills that are important, that may be relevant and different across different regions and countries about all over the world? So the question is, if we continue just following policies of different international organizations that just say you have to educate in this way, the economic has to go through this way, we are just standardizing everything over the world, and maybe not, we are not taking that chance of creating systems adapted to the needs of our own countries, and just following follow that policy of just to adapt with some small changes what some organizations tell us, maybe we will be keeping those inequity and differences over the countries. Do we need to change that there to build our own education systems, or just follow what other big organizations tell us what to do?
Okay. Can you allow the person?
Okay. Whoa, they've written it down. Organized for a bit. Yeah. I was thinking a simple question, but this guy just gave it more complex to me. I'm going to start to try to talk better. Anyway. What do you think about which policies of fight against corruption would help to get better in education? I mean, if we invest a lot in those policies of against corruption, what could we do rather than that and make those policies to get better in education? I don't know if I made myself clear.
Okay, that's good. Okay, I'm going to try and give three short answers. But it's so the first, and let me start from this one, which is, I think one of the big problems in the world is what I call global isomorphism, right? And the problem with global isomorphism is you can get a lot of credit from a lot of people by pretending to be something you're not. You know? And we see this phenomenon everywhere. It's like, look, I mean, whenever you put on a tie as a man, right? You should think, why am I putting on a tie? This is a stupid piece of cloth around my neck. But you're putting on a tie to send the signal that I'm the kind of person who wears a tie. Right? Because the person seeing you for the first time doesn't know who you are. They don't know that maybe you're not really a super productive, like, go-getter individual. But if you've got a tie on, they go, maybe he is. Right? So, the first problem is that there really is a deep problem that the kind of global world has been promulgating certain best practices that are standards that are sort of easy to mimic without actually having the guts of it work. Right? It's easy to project the image that I'm a good country on education because, I mean, your neighbors, Dominican Republic, right? Terrible education system, right? Worse than yours. Matter of fact, they dropped out of taking PISA because they just didn't want to be last again. I learned this because I was talking to the minister of Peru who called his friend and said, you bastards, why did you drop out? Now we're the worst. Okay? What did they do about it? They had a movement to spend 4% of GDP on education. Like, there is no evidentiary reason in the world to believe that's a critical factor in improving education in the Dominican Republic. None. But it's this easy, identifiable, I can go to the world and say, look, I'm a good country on education because I spend X percent of GDP. Right? As opposed to saying, what are my problems in the Dominican Republic and how would I solve them? Right? So one of the main contrasts I take is a problem-driven approach versus an isomorphic mimicry approach. Are you really doing this because you really believe in your heart of hearts that you have identified the problem in your country and you're undertaking actions that have a chance of working? Or are you doing it because you look good, because the international experts are recommending it, because other countries with successful education systems do it this way? And one of the reasons it can stay so bad, I believe one of the answers to the question of how can it stay so bad, is everybody looks like they're doing a good job. Right? Everybody creates like a Hollywood backdrop of a school. Right? Here's a school. It looks like a school. Maybe the kids are learning anything on the inside. That's hard to tell. But it looks like a school. Right? So that's, I fully agree. Now, if I then told you what policies Colombia should adapt, knowing that I've been in Colombia for 6 hours, because I arrived at 2 a.m, so now a total of 10 hours, then you would know that I'm a prophet of isomorphism. If I told you what to do, you would immediately detect that he must be a hypocrite. He's saying, don't listen to what people from the outside come and tell you is best practice. Decide for yourself, and then he's going to tell you the answer. I'm not going to tell you the answer. Okay? Second, But I am going to say some principles about the way to find the answer, right? And I'm going to sort of jump on, where'd the guy go? There he went. I'm going to answer the second question, right? I have a saying, right? This is like an aphorism or a, you can't beat a turtle to move. Say you're trying to get a turtle to go, right? You could get frustrated that the turtle's going very slow. You could get angry at the turtle. You could pull out a big stick and say, I'm going to get this turtle to go where I want to go by beating it with a stick. What's going to happen? The turtle survives as a creature because it's got hard external shell with respect to external attack. It will pull in its legs. It will pull in its head. You will wail on the poor little turtle until you're tired, until you get tired of doing that because it's completely ineffective and you go away and the turtle goes about its system. Education systems are amazingly hard-shelled turtles. Anyone who thinks they're going to reform an education system through external attack has not been engaged in education reform. So, anything that's phrased as, how do I fight against X, is the wrong way to start. Because you're already framing that you're starting a fight. Now, it's a fight against corruption. That sounds good. But do you know how people in the system, what they hear when you say fight against X? They hear fight against me. Right? So the second principle is, if you want a turtle to move, you have to work with the inside of the turtle. And some part of the turtle has to stick its neck out. So you want to be thinking, how am I going to get inside this system powerful actors who are willing to work with me and stick their neck out to move in a positive direction? And the minute it turns into a fight of us against them, them loses, us wins, typically. Which is, again, the second reason why systems can remain so bad. They're impervious to external attack. It has, reform efforts have to be collaborative from within, right? That, maybe that wasn't what you asked, but that's what the answer I wanted to give. First question is, start with the elements for quality, right? I think, let's come back to, you want to start with a problem, right? And the problem, how you frame the problem, will determine everything else you do. And the phrase quality education is a seductive phrase that you should resist. Why? Because when I say the phrase quality education, often what happens is some isomorphic response. I define the problem as the lack of a particular input, because I know that's a problem I can solve. I say, the problem with quality education is that kids don't have books, or girls don't have toilets, or the class size is too high, or some simple logistical exercise. And then I frame the problem that the lack of the inputs is the problem without ever measuring or discussing or agreeing on what we really want these schools to achieve and how we would know whether that is achieved. Right? So it's the problem definition is the key. Unless you define the problem well, you will not make progress on solutions. Or you'll make problem on solutions that aren't solutions. So I, you know, in one of the papers, there's a state of India, defined the problem as the lack of inputs, set up a management information system and budget system to make sure all the inputs were there. And during that period, learning in government schools declined and a million kids moved from the public sector to the private sector. A million kids. in exactly the same 10 years in which they were solving the problem. Because they didn't solve the problem in the way that the parents and the students saw the problem. They didn't define the problem in a way that they actually had coherency of action around it. They didn't define the problem in a way that the world could actually push back on their definition. They narrowed the problem to something they could solve. So, lots of education reform takes the characteristic of let's reduce the problem to the lack of a solution, because we know we can deliver the solution that's logistical, and that, by the way, doesn't upset anything about the reasons for the poor performance for the last 50 years, right? Okay, three more questions.
Bueno, lo que pasa es que deberías hacerla en español, pues porque ninguno habla bien, o no sé si alguien nos puede ayudar. Sí. Ah, bueno. Bueno.
¿Por qué no lo
dicen? Pero como para contextualizarlo. En el documento, en el paper que nos enviaron de la economía política del aprendizaje, hay una propuesta o hay como unas preguntas que usted hace en el texto. Las preguntas son las siguientes. ¿Por qué los gobiernos asumen la totalidad de la producción de la escuela básica y primaria? Y si no debería entregarse a terceros para que la operen, es decir, a privados. Y más adelante en el texto dice que no sería el debate sobre concentrarse en el papel del gobierno, sino más bien sobre la mejor manera de cumplir con una responsabilidad. Es decir, la responsabilidad de la operación de la educación básica primaria. La pregunta entonces, ya me puse nerviosa, es ¿por qué considera usted que entidades privadas deberían operar la educación básica y restarle esa responsabilidad a los gobiernos? Porque usted pone un ejemplo, el ejemplo de India, que el Estado emplea más de 300.000 docentes y que eso podría superar a empleadores multinacionales como McDonald's. Y que podría, digamos, descargarse esa responsabilidad de esas entidades privadas. Esa es la pregunta.
Más o menos.
Do you understand?
I have a great answer to a question like the question you asked.
No, take three. ¿Quién es el...?
Well, good morning. Our question is more like a concept question. In the paper called Where Has All the Education Gone, you talk about the human capital, like the third opportunity would be that education quality is not that good, so it's not creating the human capital that we would like it to create. So we thought that probably that concept doesn't sound very nice, when you can consider it could be like just to create productive, you know, productive people. Because nowadays, perhaps that's the most important thing when you consider all the policies that are being created around education. So we wanted to know, how do you understand that concept of human capital? And how would you, I don't know, how do you think that it would be kind of balanced with a human human education, and also, of course, a productive way to create people to promote the development of countries. Thank you.
I think that's all for the time we have. No, but I think we
have. Are we out of time?
Yeah. So I think.
Oh, wow. But let her ask the question.
Okay.
Hi to everyone. Well, I'm going to talk about the political economy of learning. In that paper, there is a table in which it is said that the government, it doesn't matter which one it is, all of them have already made a huge expansion of schooling. So if it doesn't matter which government you have, what are those factors that really matters in quality of schooling? Because if it is not the government, what it is? The private services? Thank you.
The first question was government has responsibilities, right? And then there's also the private engagement. And kind of what's the contribution of the private to the discharging of the government responsibilities, right? Okay. But I want to start from the question of does the government actually reflect the nature of the education that the society wants, right? Because there's two possibilities. One is that the government is keeping the private sector out because the government is some crazy ideological government and doesn't want people engaging in ideas that are not approved by the government. If that's the government's purpose, that I'm using education as indoctrination, I'm kind of not that thrilled about government exclusively dominating the provision of education and preventing other providers, right? On the other hand, the government could well reflect the consensus of society about what the education should be, and then there's nothing magic about either public or private. The public-private distinction is just not that important. I know in Latin America people burn down buildings on public versus private education, but it's just not that important. If the government creates a framework in which it's able to articulate what it wants out of education that reflects the social needs, you can run an all public system and be fantastic. You can run an all private system and be fantastic. If the conflict in education is a conflict in society, either within the society or between the society and the government, then public or private, it's not going to make any difference because the conflict goes deeper than that. So my take is you need to construct a system of education in which both public and private can potentially play a role in discharging the social responsibilities for which an education system exists. Right? So lots of countries in the world just have terrible, terrible, terrible governments. And in those societies, having private vastly improves the available education. Right? In other countries with good governments, there's no need for private education because the government, the public sector does a good job. Right? And precisely in those places in which the public sector does a good job at providing education, they also can provide a framework in which the private can play a good role. And precisely in those situations where the government's terrible, they're unlikely to be able to make the private be much of a productive partner. So, I just want to say, all of my thinking about systems starts from trying to articulate what the desirable principles of a system are, and only then ask the question, what's the relative allocation of tasks to actors? Rather than starting from some presumption that the government has to take a particular modality of discharging its responsibilities, right? I'm very flexible about the way in which governments discharge their responsibilities. This last question, I think the quality of education issue is not, in my mind, primarily an economic thing. So my most recent paper that's not quite done yet, you know, one of the benefits of education is that educated parents have healthier children. Exactly what we find with respect to wages and growth, we find with respect to child health. If you go to school and don't actually learn anything, guess what? It's actually not that good for your child's health to have gone to school. If you go to school and learn something, you're more productive at being a parent, and that's terrific. If you go to school and learn something, you're more productive at being a citizen, and that's terrific. So nothing about what I worry about, even though I'm an economist, with respect to the quality of learning, is narrowly tailored to its economic productivity. But disastrous reading results inhibit both the economic and the social benefits of schooling from being realized. And the promise of schooling will only be realized when it leads to the promise of an actual education. Thank you very much.